Munira Loy is the founder and CEO of Brandt International, an award-winning Malaysian company focused on customer experience, learning and training, human resource outsourcing, talent management, and business process outsourcing. Munira, who is also the founder and chairperson of the Women's Extraordinaire Foundation and president of the Professional Women Network in KL, recently led a successful M&A initiative, allowing her company to scale up and become a global player.
Funding has always been a challenge, but obviously, you know, through persistencies as well as, you know, having the right mindset allows me to be able to successfully gain help and influence investors to believe in me as well as to believe in the business. It's to be able to find purpose in their life, because the purpose will actually drives your passion in terms of identifying what you want to do.
Miss Munira Loy, founder and chief executive officer, Brandt International Sdn Bhd.
We're Brandt, a multimedia super corridor status and an award-winning Malaysian company. Ever since we started in 2004, our core mission has been to help our customers deliver the brand promise through our business consulting, customer experience transformation, people development, and business process managed services. Our key focus is on customer experience. It is the foundation for all we do. Our onshore and offshore delivery capabilities span the region. We are able to engineer end-to-end solutions for customer management and support, telemarketing, IT help desk, and HR management by leveraging on our operational, people, and IT capabilities.
Today, we are already a market leader domestically in Malaysia. It is my vision to be able to triple the workforce to be able to support the global market requirements and needs.
We help organizations make significant and radical improvements to their overall performance by tackling their most challenging issues. We ensure that your people, processes and operations consistently maintain a sharp focus on service, quality and business performance.
We have the capability to be able to work together as a team, committed with the mission of the organizations to help us to scale in the future.
That is why we have focused on building a diverse multilingual workforce, supported by next-generation AI, IT-enabled CRM platform to manage each customer interaction effectively. The combination of customer journey mapping, AI, machine learning, data analytics and automation provide us the ability to deliver personalized customer experiences on a global scale. We genuinely help our clients to achieve high-quality standards, deliver the branded customer experience and outstanding business performance. Through our cloud-based digital workforce, augmented with our Bangsa South Kuala Lumpur site, we provide the perfect nearshore capabilities to support all of Asia Pacific and beyond.
When Brandt took over our operations, we saw a minimum of 50% improvements in our case resolutions, agents' performances, and quality of our calls and emails. The team in Brandt has vast experiences in various fields that allows us to work very closely with great flexibility that caters to our needs and our expectations.
We are Brandt, making a difference and raising the bar for customer experience. One interaction at a time. That is our brand promise.
Hi, this is Munira. I'm the CEO as well as the founder of Brandt International. Do join me and my winning team for our next live show.
Hello everyone, a very good day to everyone who's joining us. A very warm welcome to the ECF campaign with Brandt International, the brand story, getting personal with the team. If you have tuned in as the previous episode, I believe as the history of the establishment of this company and also the founder sound no stranger to you. But today, with a different twist, I will not only be inviting one guest, but three individuals, as these are the key heroes of Brandt International, to have been working effectively together, to be producing a great team dynamics, to have generated a double-digit growth in the last decade. I will be introducing them very shortly. But first, allow me to welcome you to this live show of the Brandt International. My name is Arthur Tan, and I'm your designated host for today. And I'll be keeping you pumped up in the next 60 minutes. For all live viewers who are tuning in, we thank you for your time and your effort. For those who have missed out, don't worry. You can always watch the replay at any time at the comfort of your home and space on our Facebook page, Invest AQ and Brandt International. Now, before I bring our guests on the set, allow me to recap some of the key figures of what really represent Brandt International. Brandt as being one of the leading BPO companies in Malaysia. Right now, they are on a scaling up stage. They have been producing a compounded annual growth rate of 22% from 2017 to 2020. And expected to ramp up 25% per annum of a compounded annual growth rate all the way to 2025. Amid the ongoing pandemic, they have also grown their headcount by 44% to 1,000 plus strong workforce, alongside of increment of 150% of a BPO operation. They also expected to be achieving a revenues, total revenues of 44 million ringgit Malaysia this year, an increase of 37.5% as in comparison to last year. And of course, they will be ramping up their revenue growth in the years to come. Now, I wouldn't want to spoil too much beans about the Brandt International, because this time around, we do have very, very exciting team members will be joining the founder. So first on the lineup, we have none other than the CEO and the founder of Brandt International, Datuk Munira Lui.
Hi.
And joining Hello. Him would be the CEO, Andrew Chong.
Hello.
And last but not least, we have our CTO, Richard Chu.
Hi.
All right, there you are, looking very fashion coordinated. You guys brand. Look more casual than me today.
Oh, yeah. It's our brand shirt.
All right, I could tell, a walking brand as a Brandt International then. Yeah. All right, since they are also well coordinated, color coordinated, why not we get the ball rolling? So could you just quickly introduce yourself, and how does brand life look like to you on a daily basis? Yeah. Over to you, Andrew.
Okay, I'm Andrew Chong. I'm the COO. I look after overall operations for the organization. I also look after IT operations and also human resource or HR. So in terms of my experience, I have 20 over years of experience some large organization within Malaysia and global as well. So in terms of my experience profile, I very much focus around customer experience, customer operations. That's my specialty. I also spend some time in human resource. So in terms of knowledge of the operations, what I bring to the organization is my expertise in the organization I work with, whether it's with Maxis, whether it's with Shell, whether it's Singtel in Singapore or Smart in the Philippines. So I've been around quite a bit in terms of that. Most of my portfolio, I've been asked to go in and fix something. There's typically something broken in the organization and they will expect me to go in and fix it. So typically, I like to do that, and that's my specialty in what I do. Okay. On a day-to-day basis, operations spend a lot of time on operations. So spend a lot of time talking about numbers. That's what we spend our time on, numbers, and making sure we meet our customers' expectation. And these are our clients that we serve. Yeah.
I can see it's like, the growing grey hairs. Like,
yes.
Serving wisdom, yes. Like, and delivering operational excellence.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
We'll come to that part later. So, you know, yes. But yeah, over to you, so, you know, Richard.
Yeah, hi. I'm Richard Chiu. I'm the Chief Technology Officer for Brandt. So I oversee all of technology, both past, present, and future. So I've been with
Brandt for 5 years.
But prior to that, I've known Munira for at least 20, 25 years. Yeah. I was a CTO for Citibank Berhad, and that's where I met Munira. And prior to that, I was also in Leisure Holidays and MBF, also with Munira. Yeah. So we've known each other for a very long time.
Is this where the clients, you know, became part of a working family right now?
Oh, yes.
I remember the strong relationship that was cultivated. Thank you, Richard. Yeah. And over to you. So, you know, I mean, Dato, you play, so, you know, definitely several heads, multiple heads in this organization. What does really brand life, daily life, so, you know, does to you?
Well, certainly 16 years, you know, having started this company, it has been certainly a very enriching journey for myself. But prior to starting a brand, I actually already have about 20 years of corporate experience, of which 15 years has been primary in the banking sector. And my functions or capabilities that I have gained throughout the corporate arena has always been around organization development, change management, CX, digital transformation initiatives, business process re-engineering work, as well as project management. Yeah. So the role of what I do today, I like to say this, it's coffee, and networking. But, well, joke aside, essentially what I do, it's really to actually help the organization to scale to a revenue size of 100 million and, you know, moving towards a valuation of 300 million. And essentially what it means, it's, you know, the focus for me has always been to try to always look for opportunities to collaborate and partners with potential M&A and helping the organization to grow both organic as well as in the inorganic way, right? And very much about value creation as well, and working with a lot of key stakeholders in the industry with government agencies to help create value for the company.
Right, yeah. Thank you very much. And yeah, there you are. So, you know, these are the key heroes of Brandt International. So, I mean, apart, so, you know, from the daily tasks and also the your deliverables, so, you know, that you achieve in Brandt International, what exactly is, you know, are the toughest challenges, so, you know, in your current position right now, and how do you overcome it?
I think from an operational perspective, because we are a people business, right? You mentioned we have thousands of staff. So one of the key challenges is to basically manage a large workforce, not only in one location, because we have now three locations, but we also have locations in the client side in terms of the number of clients we have. So managing that workforce, we need to have a strong team, right? Yeah. So to overcome the challenge is really to bring in a strong bench strength, right? So that you make your work easier for yourself. But also, you need to keep an eye on things, right? So the eye to basically being very detailed in terms of what you do is very, very important. So for me, my biggest challenge is managing the large workforce. But we have a good team that basically manages that. Yeah.
That's from the operational side. So, yeah. And what about yourself, Andrew, from the technology adoption?
Yeah.
So, Richard. Richard is my dad's name. And Richard is, you know, as my dad, he's a very operational person, so, you know, in the house. So, yeah, so, pardon me if I'm going to get myself.
No problem, no problem.
Yes, Richard.
Yeah, so for technology, there's basically two fronts. One is the daily operation. So we're going to make sure that it runs every morning, 365 days in a year. And because we run a contact center for 24/7, right? So we've got to make sure that it's up and running. So by doing that, we built a robust, redundant infrastructure and systems in place. So that's operationally. The next one is, of course, innovation. How do you continue to innovate and bring yourself to the future? Making yourself better and better in a competitive world. So those are the two key areas for technology. that I look at.
Dato, I mean, 100 million, you know, and it's not too far sight from how the company is, you know, has been achieving.
Right.
And of course, it's like the pandemic also has been helping Brandt International to be really ramping up the revenue.
Yeah.
I mean, with an EBITDA, a positive net that you all will be achieving of 2.5 million ringgit Malaysia.
Yeah.
I think that's astonishing. So, you know, that's something that, you know, most companies can't even get there. You know, most companies are now even just talking about survivorship.
Yeah.
You know, so what will be the greatest challenge? I mean, you seem to have already put everything in place.
Yeah.
You have a great team, you know, a right technology to be adopted, operational excellence. But really, what will be the real challenge, the intrinsic challenges, you know, to be getting into the 100 million benchmark?
Sure. Well, I guess, you know, it's there's always a the growing pains of, you know, companies that are scaling. And one of the challenge that I currently face at this point is primarily raising funds to support our business growth. And what this really means is to be able to influence the investors and, you know, telling our story, because in a pandemic situation, it's our story appears to be too good to be true. All right, but so it's really about how do you influence investors to tell them that, you know, hey guys, these are the facts,
and numbers online.
Yeah, and this is where we are, and you know, we kind of need the support. So I think that's one of the major obstacles from my perspective. And the second key thing, obviously, it's the market access. We have grown beyond you know, just looking at domestic market, and is our vision now. We are ready for regional markets at this point, but however, with the pandemic, you know, the borders are closed at this point, so certainly this you know serve as an obstacle for us to you know, to, with the travel ban, you know, we have difficulty in exploring new markets, and that in itself has essentially lengthened the sales cycle, right? So those probably the two main challenges that I currently face.
So in short, how will you overcome all this?
Well, ECF is obviously one of the platforms that we're looking at, you know, to kind of work towards raising the funds, at least for this. And market access, obviously, as what Richard has mentioned, it's about, you know, how we innovate and how do we ride on the digital platforms, you know, to get to access to markets that we are, you know, that we are working towards. And, you know, we've been fortunate to be able to get ourselves market presence through various means to actually, you know, reach out to those markets that we want to serve.
So this is why here we are today, Brandt International, being the very first time raising up money from public since incorporation 16 years ago. And would also be, you know, the last ECF campaign for people, for the Malaysians, for investors to be participating. So I believe with that, Datuk, you have probably something to share?
Yeah, sure. I will kind of work towards a couple of slides for the audience here. As you can probably see on the slide now, Brandt International's primary objective with our clients is we help organizations to deliver customer experience and business value primarily through our operational and people excellence, with a very niche business model, which is primarily in the space of business process outsourcing. So currently our clients are essentially very high growth internet companies, as you probably see the logos on the right side of the screen. So they are high growth internet companies as well as MNCs. And we not only serve Malaysia, which is our primary markets, but our other markets in terms that we serve are essentially in Singapore, China, as well as in Hong Kong. I started a company about 16 years ago, and today we have gone through three adversities. We not only have survived, but also thrive in that process. We have grown, you know, since 2009, a CAGR growth, revenue growth of 22%. And this year will represent our record year, with coming in at about 44 million with our 2.5 EBITDA. Yeah? And on an average today, we handle about 15,000 customer interactions, and which is equivalent to more than 5 million interactions per year. So what this means is we actually support our clients in managing their customers through the voice channel or in the non-voice channel, which is via web chats, via email chats, and other forms of digital platforms in this case here. All right. So how do we see ourselves as a bridge? We see ourselves as a bridge between the business as well as their customers. So if you looked at from a customer's perspective, we know today the customers are generally more demanding than before. They're no longer dependent on one single channel of interactions when they deal with any organizations. Now, on the other hand, if you looked at the business today, we're also seeing a lot of business are very slow in adapting to the evolving customers' needs, especially in the digital transformation space, right? So we've always says that digital transformation used to be a smart strategy, but today it is a survival strategy. But obviously business today are finding it challenging to very quickly pivot their business. So what do we see is that we see ourselves as the bridge, connecting the disconnects, and by the ability of us able to offer what we call a digital omni-channel platform that will allow us to help our clients to manage their whole customer experience throughout the whole customer life journey. Now, beyond the business segment, as we have shared, we also see that we are currently also our growth is being accelerated as a result of the pandemic. Now, you probably see in the slide now that Malaysia has proven ourselves to be essentially very resilient. During the pandemic, in view of our great infrastructure and network, we were able to essentially move and migrate our operations to work from home with very little challenges as compared to our neighboring countries like India as well as in the Philippines, where they face with numerous challenges. So we have proven ourselves, Malaysia has proven ourselves to be very resilient in times of COVID, and we're beginning to see a lot of potentials in the global market who's now essentially looking at Malaysia as an alternative location for them to actually hub their business services sector. And because of this, you therefore see that we experienced a very high growth in our BPO operations in the last 6 months. Our BPO operations grew by 150% in terms of our headcount. And as an enterprise, our headcount grew by 44% in the last 6 to 8 months. So organically, we will double our today's revenue by 2023. The last 3 years essentially was very focused on refining our business model. But this year represents our turning point where we're going to hit our record revenue of 44 million with an EBITDA of 2.5 million. And we're going to focus on the next 3 years to scale up. All right. And then once we reach our 100 million, that's where value realization will come in. We're happy to say that year 2021, our revenue of 57 million, it's already confirmed 100% book sales. While 2022 and 2023, we already have 60 to 80% confirmed businesses. So once we reach 2023 with 100 million in terms of revenue, there is what we call an exit plan in place for the company. So today we are essentially raising 5 million investments, and primarily there are four key areas for us to utilize the fund. The first primary is to actually move away from a transactional contact center player into an AI-enabled player. So what we're going to do is we're going to work on AI and robotics upgrade as one of our key considerations for the funds that we're going to raise. The second key objective of raising the funds utilization is primarily for working capital. The third is really to strengthen our sales and marketing efforts, because now we are no longer looking at domestic markets, but we're also looking at regional markets. And the last key thing, it's really about the debt repayment. So the company, essentially, the growth will be essentially driven by a deep bench strength of management team, as you probably been introduced to Andrew as well as Richard. And we come with loads of experience from large MNCs. And what we bring to the table or to the organization, it's governance, best practice, process, and framework to actually help the organizations to take the company to the next level. So with this, I believe I'm going to stop here first, Arthur.
And absolutely.
Yeah, yep. And then we're going to come back again for the next part of the section. Yeah.
Very well-timed presentation. And yeah. There you go. Thank you very much, Datuk, for walking us through what Brandt is an international. For those who have missed out, you know, the previous show, this is really good, again, you know, for all the live viewers, you know, to be recapping the backgrounds, you know, of Brandt National. And of course, I certainly agree, you know, with Datuk, that what an astonishing results, you know, that have been produced by Brandt International. But it's never about a one-man show. It's always about the team dynamics, putting, you know, the right relevant experience, expertise in delivering, you know, the respective role alongside, you know, with a great technology adoption at the right time. So there's a lot of business acumen and intuitions, you know, to have put in place that were set them, you know, a little bit more comfortable, I would say, you know, 44 million right, you know, at the tipping point and scaling up, you know, to 57 million. And kudos to that.
Yeah.
That where, you know, on books, it has already been secure. It's a great business. So, you know, if I know that it's already been secure next year, I need not to worry much, you know, about my revenue. Yeah.
I guess the interesting part of this is because, you know, the nature of how the contract essentially is structured.
Absolutely, yes.
It's typically once we win the project, you know, it actually entails 2 to 3 years contract, right? So if we booked this year, then the next 3 years, you know, we can essentially recognize the revenue as
And that gives us a good comfort, you know, at least able to take a step back and focus into something larger to be expanding, you know, either market or market size, you know, or even, you know, some potential acquisitions, you know, that's in the pipeline.
In fact, that's essentially how we evolved. When we started way back in 2004, we were very much a consulting company. And you know that a consulting business does not have a sustainable business model, and that's why we have evolved our business and to what we are today, whereby, you know, we want to look at a business model that can allow us to be sustainable, right? And this is the BPO is you know, a space that allows us to have that.
Yeah, so this is the reason why I think today we really have Andrew and Richard today, really, I mean, joining us.
Yeah.
At least giving you lesser time to be speaking.
Yes.
A lot of talking that, you know, Datuk has to do, you know, in the first. Even a lengthier, you know, presentation as well. But, you know, that was really a great snapshot, you know, of what really entails as a Brandt International. Now, I mean, as today, it's really getting personal, you know, with the team, and I couldn't figure out a better way, you know, to get personal with them in a fun way. Let's just put, you know, business aside. It's not all work and business all the time, you know. So I believe that, you know, let's really get to know them, you know, slightly a bit better, you know, on the personal side. So we'll begin, you know, with Andrew, Datuk, and Richard, right?
Okay.
In sequence, then,
So let's get this is gonna be fun.
So very impromptu, you know. So I'm just gonna ask them. Just answer as snappy as possible, as fast as possible, right?
Okay.
Can you guys do that then?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay.
It's gonna get it's gonna get a little bit, you know, quirkier, you know, as the question goes by. Let's be prepared with that then. So yes, let's get a ball. Are you a morning bird or a night owl?
Morning, definitely.
Late morning.
Oh, I'm a night owl. You know, big eyes.
That's why we are 24 hours.
Absolutely, yeah. So this is like a market, Jenna. A market that operates for 24 hours. Coffee or tea?
Coffee, black.
Coffee, flat white.
Oh, coffee, flat white. Yeah.
What is the first thing you do, is, you know, when you wake up in the morning?
Look at my phone.
Not looking at yourself?
No mirror in the bedroom.
Handphone as well.
For me, it's reaching out for my coffee. It perks me up, gets me going.
You really do love saying coffee up. I'm probably going to ask you, who does the coffee then?
Okay.
What's on your working desk?
Oh, my picture is always Liverpool because I've been supporting them for so many years.
I'm a diehard Apple, so it's all Apple gadgets on my table.
Yeah. For technology, it has to be devices, right? I got my phone, my laptops, you know, my monitors.
Yeah.
What's on your smartphone home screen?
Liverpool as well. Diehard.
Airtime for a Liverpool and Apple right now.
Yeah. Apple logo.
I've got a Samsung team that says now or never. So do it now or never.
There's a lot of airtime for a couple of brands we're hearing right now. So would you rather hike together with Kanye West or run with Lewis Hamilton?
Neither.
Okay, then why not I tweak the question there? would you do hiking with Mariah Carey or running with Ariana Grande?
Ariana, definitely.
Ariana, too.
Yeah.
Right.
Not sure I can keep up with her, but yeah.
While serenading a song to you there. Yeah. Yeah. Do you,
Dato? Oh, for me, it will be hiking.
Yeah. Kanye West or Lewis Hamilton?
Arthur.
Wow. Right now.
Well, I can't run, so yeah. It's hiking for me. And I love the environment, yes. The nature, so it's hiking for me.
Okay. Yeah. What's the biggest work pet peeve?
Oh, I've been late. Don't like to
Coming
be late.
Coming from an operational person? Yep.
Well, for me, it's someone playing victim.
Oh.
Yeah.
For me, it's coming to the office for a meeting and finding that he's there before me.
And he's always going to be there, right? Because he's the operational person, he's the COO. And the CTO is a night owl. Yeah. So won't be waking up early in the morning meetings there.
Yeah.
Your favorite non-sports related activity is?
Drinking wine.
Mm. K-drama for me.
K-drama, wow. That's seeing the sentimental part of our eye lady over here.
Just
crash
finish,
landing on
just
you.
Just finish startup.
Crash landing on you. Oh, okay. All right.
Startup of a business?
So crash landing on you or Itaewon class?
Both.
Or Windows Sonata?
Both.
Well, for me, it's totally different. For me, it's virtual reality, which is Oculus. Yeah.
Coming from a tech guy, right now in the virtual world here. The biggest disruption in your workday is?
No, if I work from home, it's my cat, which likes a lot of attention. So that's the disruption.
And where do you put your cat then?
Try to put it outside the study, but you know.
Too much noise then.
Yeah.
Same here is my cat, since I work from home most of the time. And he occupies my seat.
For me, when I do my Zoom, I try and get all my dogs. I got about 4 dogs, right? All quiet. Out of the blues, the motorbike will come along and they go, wow, 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 wow. That's my...
And of course, last but not least, as I know, who has been your greatest influence and why?
That would be my mom. Because when I was young, I saw her go through the hard times, being very resilient. Working hard to what you want to achieve. And that, I think, has passed down a bit to me in terms of my beliefs, in terms of what I want to achieve in life. So definitely, for me, it's definitely my mom. Yeah.
Okay, we seem to have a lot of things in common, right? Well, it's certainly my mom, and she is certainly very physically as well. She's mentally strong. She's very compassionate. She puts in a lot of humanity, and she has that giving behavior in her. And I guess that's how I've got that humanity in myself. She does have an impact on not only me, but my siblings as well. She has never disappointed us, you know, as a mom.
For me, it's my parents, of course, mother and father. But father stands out, my dad stands out a little bit more.
You're always different, man, Richard.
Yeah, always.
Yeah, the two of you seem to be always...
Yeah, he's always different.
Are you an ally here or what? It's a good contrast.
Yes. So my dad has always this calming effect. And he's never, or maybe once or twice, brought in anger. But he's very calm. And he's taught me the calmness. He's passed the calmness over to me. Mm-hmm. Especially in technology, you need to be calm-headed, level-headed.
Yeah.
In whatever situation.
Yeah.
And tackle the problem. Yeah. Tackle the issue.
Yeah.
And there you go. We saw the other side of all these heroes, the key heroes of Brandt International. Of course, I always believe that no matter how mighty you are, so, you know, but there's always that emotional and sentiment part, so, you know, of the leadership management. And then what really makes us a great management team in Brandt is the one thing that they believe, apart from the profitability, one of the really key reasons that they have built, you know, are of 44%, so, you know, of a headcount growth to a 1,000 strong workforce. It's the humanity part, so, you know, and I believe that, you know, there's three key members here, so, you know, of Brandt will agree with me that nothing is more priceless, so, you know, than the humanity. And thank you so much, so, you know, for sharing. Yeah. Truly, really getting up close and personal.
Yeah. You know?
So let's get back to, you know, to business. Unfortunately, because it's only 1 hour, so just right on time still, we have half an hour more. Let's get back to business. I would like to understand more, a bit more, on the operational excellence right now. I mean, Brandt International, so, you know, has been recording, so, you know, 22%. It has been a double-digit growth, so, you know, for the last 10 years. Because in 2017, so, you know, we saw so in 22% and ramping up, so, you know, to 25% for next year to 2025, you know, with that. So how is this operational, so, you know, being executed, and what have been the drastic changes in years to come? Moving forward.
So one of the things we believe in is really focus on the customer, right? Or customer experience. Because we have the number of clients that we manage, we don't treat the clients' customers as not our customers. We must treat them as our customers. So the one thing that we truly believe in is the focus on the customers. If you look at our portfolio, we have customers that have been with us for over 10 years. And that's the long-term relationship we've built with them. And because we've been there for more than 10 years, these are the people who will actually give us testimonial and actually recommend customers to us as well. And that has happened many times over. So a lot of our customers that you see in our portfolio has been with us for a very long time. Some that are new, they work with us because, again, when you focus on the customer, you focus on what the customer needs. Because we have so many clients, each one of them has different needs and requirements. But all of it centered around the customer. So one of the things that we always focus on is really look at that. Second thing that is really crucial is the speed of execution. Because the environment is so dynamic, and this was so true when the MCO came in. There were so many things that we need to look at in terms of, number one, getting the team to work from home, having the solutions. We have one of our clients who wanted to ramp up, and they actually asked us, could you ramp up within the next 2 weeks? With new office space and new equipment. We didn't say no. We said, okay, we'll check and we'll get it done, right? We came back to them in the next day to say, yep, we're able to do it. Because the surrounding team is clear in terms of saying, do not let the customers down, right? And that's where the speed of execution comes in terms of what you need to do. The last one that's probably very important is to continue to focus on the operations. And this way you add value to the organization, not only in terms of operation excellence, run the operations well, but also add value. One of the things that you can actually recommend and change for the client and work with the clients and really add value to the overall organization. I don't think you should go in and say, okay, I'm just doing this contract. This is the value of the contract. Let's just do that. But you need to continuously add value. How do you increase that? Moving forward, in terms of how we organize ourselves as a team, it will still be very much those formulas. What we need to add on is actually the bench strength, bringing a lot more knowledgeable expert into the team so that we can continue to serve the customer very, very well. I think that's one of the things that we have been focusing on, and that has worked well for us.
I mean, humans come from a various background, and of course, it's like if you hire the more experienced ones, you know, and certainly there's also a certain personality. I do play a fair bit as like, you know, in an operation in my previous organization, and honestly, managing people is like, I think I'm surprised that, you know, you have only accumulated this amount.
I still have hair. I'm surprised. I still have hair.
I mean, come on, Andrew, it's 1,000 plus, it's like a strong workforce. 1,000 individuals coming from various backgrounds, different personality. How do you really keep them all in line?
Okay.
So, and to really mush together, so, you know, towards the vision, so, you know, of the company.
Okay.
Walk us through, you know, the exact communications or the alignments, you know, of the operational.
Yeah. as you can see from our team, right, we are very open and very transparent. And it's more like you're working as friends rather than more than colleagues.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's one of the things that we build.
Yeah.
And we do ask the team to look at the management team. Look at how we behave as a team. So kind of mimic that. The different personality is great because each one of them comes in with their strength. So one of the things we need to do is tap what are their strengths. And because of that, when we look at the team, it's about the organization as well. Are you organized well? Does each member of the team knows exactly how they contribute to the overall success of the team? Making sure they understand that and making sure that they have the tools and the knowledge to support that. If they don't have it, we will be there to help them gain the knowledge. One of the things that we also tell the team a lot, don't be afraid to make mistakes.
Yeah.
Because that's where you learn. When you make mistakes, you learn. We learn from that mistake, but hopefully don't do it again. If you do it again, then too bad, right? But we need to allow people in the organization to make mistakes. They do make mistakes. Things happen, but we recover fast, right? If something happens, things will happen, right? That's why if you look at how we work together as a team, there's so many chat groups now, and this technology does help. The number of WeChat, the WhatsApp, all the number of chat groups. We have a group called BCP, Business Continuity Plan. We have a group for IT. We have a group for COVID. So we're always on top of it. And we tell everybody in the group, do not be afraid to rest and alert so that we can actually come and help if we need to. I think the diversity is there.
Mm-hmm.
Having a very strong team. Right, as you can see from the team that Datuk presented just now, the number of people in the teams has got the expertise. We can't do it alone.
Yeah.
It has to be done with the team,
and
you need the bench strength. And appreciating where each of us come from, that's how we work best together. I think even myself and Richard, we would have disagreements, but that's work.
Yeah.
Right? After work, we can go out and have a laugh and have a drink and have food. Right? We center around that a lot.
Yeah.
So that's important. I think that's how we kind of get everybody together to work with a single goal. As long as everybody is clear how and what you need to do to deliver the company's objective. So we're quite clear in terms of that.
Yeah, I think the culture is very important.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the culture set by Munira.
Yeah.
And that, you know, all of us follow. Yeah,
yeah.
All the management team follows.
Yeah.
And everyone follows the same culture.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think, just to write on, I think, you know, we are a management team who are essentially very hands-on.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that allows us to kind of make very quick decisions.
Yes.
And I think the speed of decision is very key in driving the execution part of it.
Correct.
What I also see is that while we are hands-on, there's a lot of empowerment that we also give to our employees.
Right? Correct.
Because there's a trust that has been built. And, you know, allowing the employees to explore. I think that's really living one of our values, right? It's really about that spirit of adventure. It's allowing the employees to be curious, to explore new things, to innovate, to make mistakes, and grow in that process as well.
Mm.
Yeah.
It's a very people industry, you know, and it's something that I always tell this, as you know, even to my business partner, if I have a choice, I would rather communicate with a machine and not people.
Really?
and that's one thing that I think what you guys are doing is astounding to me. It's, you know, I mean, internal people, external people, client expectation, customers, you know, experience, excellence. There's a lot of people, so, you know, involvement, so, you know, over here.
I think after this is even more important now that COVID has come in, you know, with people working from home, with digital, you know, coming into play, the humanity must not be lost, right? I mean, in fact, it becomes more important now to ensure that, you know, the people can collaborate, regardless whether we are working from home or even at the office aspect of it. So to us, communication, it's the utmost importance, right, in driving our deliverables.
Just quickly define your leadership style as a CEO.
Well, I've always been very open, very transparent. I say very, very much like what you see. One of my roles is not to be micromanaging.
Yeah.
I know my numbers very well, right? The one thing that I get every on an hourly basis are the numbers of the of how we are basically serving our clients and the customer. So numbers I know very well. Once in a while, I drop in a message. But like what Munira said, they are very empowered to basically come up with a solution. Typically, my team comes to me and said, there's an issue. I will ask them, what are the solutions? Right? Mm. Because you should have the solutions. Yeah. And if they have two or three, I ask them, what would you recommend?
Yeah.
Because we need to talk it out. Right? I don't have the best ideas. Right? I always tell the team, I do not have the best ideas in the room. Right? So we need to talk it out and discuss among ourselves. And then we make a decision as a team. Right? However, if there are tough decisions that need to be made, I'll make it. Right? So if in business, I need to make a tough decision, I will make that. Yeah. But I'm very transparent with the team, very open. So very collaborative as a team, even within my own team or within across the organization. Yeah. And that's the way our ways of working. Yeah. Yeah.
Don't give them a fish, by giving them a bait to catch the fish then.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. I mean, I could resonate some of the sentiments as they have expressed. Now, from operational flow, of course, all these are also being very well aided by technology adoption. I mean, over to you, Richard. In 2019, Brand International is going to have invested heavily. I mean, for all those live viewers who have also tuned in on the previous episode, you know, Datuk did mention that 2019 was the year with a business acumen, intuition. I mean, the whole idea why Brandt International's in a large workforce, but yet will still have no issues working remotely or I rather say work mobility that has been going on very seamlessly this year, and it's just I would say that the COVID-19 pandemic was a blessing in disguise. Could you just describe in depth this whole technology adoption? First, from the area of the efficiency, because it will be increasing from 15,000 to 18,000 client transactions on a daily basis. Am I getting my numbers right? Because right beside me. Now I'm a bit nerve-wracking. Right, so 15,000 to 18,000, and that's definitely a huge growth in that. So could you just share with us what exactly this technology entails?
So we started our digital journey right about 3-4 years back, and during that time, this digital transformation that we underwent led us on a 5-year roadmap to move us from day-to-day work into a digital area. So we were fortunate. In 2019, we invested in the infrastructure, the systems, and this has enabled us during the pandemic, right, to be able to move all our agents to work from home, thereby allowing our customers excellent service, customer experience. So we were quite seamless. In fact, I remember before the MCO, 2 days before we got together, strategized what to do. And on that day of the MCO, we were all working from home seamlessly.
Until now, right?
So it's infrastructure, systems in place, and embarking on a digital journey, a transformation journey that will transform your company, in and out. So I think that's the key. So within that, of course, is the underlying technology. What technology do you embrace to do that? And to ensure that you have security and compliance across. So you have to ensure that, you have data security all the way from end to end.
Richard, I mean, with the presentation from Datuk just now, I noticed that the biggest allocations, will be into the robotics and also the AI adoption. Of course, we are here, not to trying to understand, that AI is going to improve efficiency. So 28%, will be allocated, into adoption of technology. How is this going to be invested, in trenches? And what are the kind of desired results that Brandt is going to deliver to the customers or partners, as well as to the team, internal team as well?
Right. So as part of our digital journey and transformation, we have reached a stage where we have got very good infrastructure, very good systems in place. Munira shared with you about the omnichannel call center that we have, right? So the next step is to take it forward into the future, to future-proof our environment. And the only way to do that is to get into AI, artificial intelligence and robotics. So can you imagine a world, you know, I'm on Oculus, virtual reality. When I was 18 years old, I would never imagine that. Mm. But now it's almost seamless.
Yes. Right.
So the future is in AI, where a robot will then attend to the customer's needs, but it will not be robotic. It will be almost human-like. So AI is about bringing humanity into the robotic space.
So there'll be like a newborn Sophia.
Yeah.
What is the name of the robot that's going to be?
We haven't found it yet. But in the essence, right, you will get an agent calling you now,
yeah,
or you talking to an agent, and the future would be the AI taking over part of that conversation, addressing your needs, and being able to understand your emotions, your sentiments as you speak, so that you will not just ramble on a, you know, as though it's just a tape,
right,
script recording,
yeah,
but it is more human-like. You'll be able to understand your tonality, right, and address it and take you to the next step. You'll also be able to interface with your client's legacy system to pull out information about what you want, and give you that information. There's also, you know, AI, multi-language capabilities. Right. So right now we are in Malaysia, right? I mean, if we want to support Russia, we would have a problem with the Russian language. But AI has the capability of doing automatic translation. So we'll be supporting Russia, and when a customer calls up in Russia, we could have an English-speaking guy over here, and AI will translate it. Can you imagine that? So it's like having a hologram agent right in front of you, talking to you.
I look forward to seeing that, and I believe our people are also slowly adopting that. They can accept that as well. There are a few conglomerate companies that are have really started riding on it.
Right.
And when it comes to customer service, as much as sometimes these robots cannot answer the exact question that I'm asking them, they will keep giving me options, but it makes business perfect sense.
Exactly.
But and there are more, especially customer service, you know, administrations, even accountancy as well.
Yeah. Right.
But those are robots without AI in place, right?
Yeah.
So it's scripted and just continue giving you options.
Mm. Mm.
But that's why we want to move away. We don't want to do that, right? We want to move into an AI arena.
Yeah.
All right,
I think just to ride on to what Richard says is that, you know, we are self-destructing ourselves, right? You know, in order for us to stay competitive in the marketplace, because technology is destructing the world, right? So what we want to do is to move away from today, we are very transactional BPO player, to that of an AI-enabled BPO player. And that, in essence, will kind of create that differentiator from ourselves with that of our competition itself here. So we are very serious, you know, in this game plan, and you know, and we believe very strongly that this will be our key differentiator moving forward. You know.
And when this takes place, where does the humanity comes?
I think that's where it basically makes your operations a lot more efficient.
Right.
Let's say, for example, what Richard mentioned, right? When we do an outbound telesales call to anyone today, the agent has to do it themselves, right? You have to talk to the customer to validate you, who you are. Are you free to talk to us? That can be now done by AI.
Yes.
So once that's done by the AI, once you have qualified that you are free, you can talk to us, then you will pass to a human agent to close the sale. So you don't lose the fact that you need less people. No. It basically makes your workforce a lot more efficient and effective in terms of completing the transaction. So for that, when you talk to our clients or to our customers about that, they will be tremendously happy with that, because it gives us a lot more efficiency and effectiveness.
Right.
Also can apply for quality assurance. If you look at quality assurance today, we cannot listen to all the calls to find out the issues with the customers. With AI, they can skim all the calls.
Right.
That means you can almost 100% be certain that any mistakes made along the way will be picked up by the AI and said, I think this transaction wasn't done properly. That makes us a lot more efficient, effective. And from that perspective, the customer experience will actually be enhanced.
Yeah.
Right? So it doesn't mean that you get less headcount. It means that you basically become more effective and efficient. Yeah. And that's what we're looking forward to as well.
Yeah. That's right. So, you know, a lot of front-end stuff that the agents are doing now can be offloaded to the robots. And the agents will continue to do their part. They can close faster. They can address the customer's needs better. And the AI robot will be able to then provide that information to the agent for them to relate to the customer.
And that's where the humanity part comes in.
Yeah. Right.
Because you are prioritizing the customer need, the customer operation excellence. And when customers are delighted, of course, then you know the humanity will come as a natural.
That's right.
All right, there you go. I mean, thank you so much, Richard and Andrew. We have heard the how more in depth, from the operational flows as well as technology adoption part. I think it gets really interesting. It's the vision has always been set as a mandate, and regardless of whatever adoptions they're going to put on, it's still going to resonate to the foundations of the establishment. Mm. Right. So with that, I think I will pass it on back to Datuk.
Yeah.
Has some things to share. As we are here, those who just tuned in of the ECF campaign with Brandt International, this is the brand story, getting up close and personal with the team. And it's their first and only ECF campaign that they will be participating in the last 16 years. And after that, they will either go for a trade sale or so an IPO. So I believe this is an opportunity for everyone to be grabbing on. So over to you, Dato.
Right. Thanks, Arthur. Time essentially flies very fast.
So it's a triple fun right now. Your job has been triple.
So as shared earlier, we are now in the process of raising 5 million through the ECF platform under Pitchin. And what is in store for the investors essentially is that the exit for investors in the next 3 to 5 years is expected to be 2x the ROI of 15 to 26% IRR. And obviously there are two options for us to do an exit. One is primarily through the trade sales and the second is through the IPO. The trade sales, it's where we are currently potentially looking at PE investors or larger BPO players. Today are essentially very active in this space, but we are still considering ourselves as being very small at this point. We believe that once we reach a revenue size of at least 100 million, we are in a very sweet spot to actually commence conversations with this kind of PE investors. Now, obviously, the next route is really the IPO state. We could list now, but what we really want to do is to be able to achieve what we call a valuation of 300 million in order for us to be able to the value realization becomes more meaningful and worthwhile for our key stakeholders. So our next 2 to 3 years is primarily to actually grow to a big enough size so that we have options to realize the company values. So let me just very quickly summarize some of the couple of key highlights that we've shared in this presentation. Number one, we are one of the largest BPO players in Malaysia today. And certainly we are riding the tailwind of outsourcing in as far as Malaysia proven themselves to be essentially very resilient during the pandemic situation. Second, we have actually survived and thrived three adversities. And we have proven ourselves in all this crisis, our performance have actually exceeded in terms of our revenues and overall performance. Now, there is really the third key thing. It's we are certainly not a startup. So there is really no startup risk. We are fast growing and we've proven ourselves for the last 16 years, right? And we've shared with you a lot of financials. To validate, the financial health and the growth potentials in our business. And our role today would be really to focus on achieving the 300 million valuation company in the next 2 to 3 years. So what is in store for listeners at this point of time is we are currently in the pre-live stage. We are actually looking at raising 2 million during the pre-live stage. And for a minimum investment of 2,645 ringgit, you will get 50 shares in the company. During the pre-live, obviously we will be giving a 15% bonus share, which means you will get an additional of 8 shares. So for 2,645 ringgit, you will get 58 shares in the company. So that's during the pre-life stage. Once we achieve our 2 million, we will go into live, and once you're live for 2,645 ringgit, you will only get 50 shares of the company. So the message is, invest right now.
That's right. Act now, invest now. Otherwise, so you'll be missing out the opportunity from a minimum of 2,645,
yes,
which will sum up as equivalent about 80 or ringgit per day.
Yeah.
And you were able to three-fold your money within the next 3 to 5 years, or will be increasing by 15% to 26% as ROI. I don't know how the numbers also suddenly flow into my mind.
Yeah.
I think give me the lucky chance, Andrew. You're sitting right beside you. Somehow, somewhere. But yes, 15% to 26% ROI. We are looking at six times more than your fixed deposit, right? Right now, fixed deposit declined.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, so I think, I believe strongly this is a worthwhile investment. You have seen and you have heard and you have experienced it on your own, not just for 1 month, but our 3 month over here, from a customer client to a working family today. I think what really makes this really deal very different as compared to many other ECF, 16 years, and this is the first time they're raising up money from public. And it's a very rare sight to see in business today. And of course, to echo once again, what Datuk said, there's no startup risk at all in the event if you're afraid. So yes, act now, take action right now. This is your golden opportunity. Now we have a couple of questions, of course. Right. It's time to, we're not forgetting you, live viewers, be it whether on social media as well as Zoom. So we have a couple of questions, so I can just pass it on to anyone who would like to answer this, to pick up the question. So I would like to know from Datuk and team, what are some of the specific actions that you are taking to foster innovation mindset in your teams?
Okay, so I'll start
that
off.
Yeah, right.
So we have an innovation lab within Brandt, and what we do is that we try and explore new technologies. Technology is it's out there. There's so many different technologies. How do you embrace it? We allow, at least for my team also, to test them out, to test bait them out, so that we will know which technology is suitable and which is not. Yeah. So to me, it's a people culture. You have to continuously cultivate it in everyone, that there is always an innovation, small, big, just to do it.
And you keep adapting to it. So, the foresight that for you to have is very important, and
sure.
And digital's transformation really changes very fast.
Right.
So how do you bring that relay that message to your management team and for the management teams to be sharing to the executive team as well, that innovation mindset?
Yeah, I guess we do have what we call both the formal structure as well as the informal structure that allows us to deliberate, the business plans and the ideas of innovation on an ongoing basis. Now, when we talk about the formal channel, essentially we have what we call our, yearly business planning review meetings, or what we call offsite. We are having one coming in the next 2 weeks' time. So essentially during the business review, we are generally very critical about, what has happened in the previous year, and what do we need to do to move things forward itself here. So we use a very structured process to navigate the company to where they are now to where we want to be in the future itself. So that's primarily very much the formal structure, and obviously on a quarterly basis, I sit into the management reviews to see, to track how things are progressing. But Andrew is driving the management meetings on a weekly basis. And that has been done with a lot of discipline, you know, to ensure that things are essentially done on track. And if there's any challenges, you know, it's addressed and you know, and things move on itself here. So the focus for us has always been execution, right? I mean, you've got great plans, but if you lack the execution capabilities, it's you're not going to get anywhere, right? And I believe through this formal structure that we've put in place, it allows us to kind of, you know, move things essentially very fast itself here. And that's where, you know, the innovation and looking at ways of how to combat a problem or a challenge that we face, it comes very readily for the people, right? So that's one. And of course, in the informal way, we do have our town hall meetings, we have our dialogue sessions with our staff and all that. So repeatedly, we've always been talking about empowerment, we've been talking about the directions of the company, and at the same time, it's about learning by doing, learning by mistakes. So all those things are essentially communicated to let people know that it's okay to make mistakes.
Yep.
You know, what is important is we would like to hear the ideas and you know, views and all that. And that in itself, it's very empowering for the organization. Right? And it speaks a lot about the culture. Right?
Yep.
Very well said. Thank you so much, Asa, for the enthusiasm. Yeah. Fail fast, succeed faster.
Yeah.
You know, there's always rooms, you know, for space to make mistakes. But so long you don't repeat the same mistake again.
Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Otherwise, then it's like, you know, you'll be a fool.
Yeah. Right.
That's what I was being taught. Like, I mean, we just have sometimes, you know, just to pick up one more question.
Yeah.
One more question. There's some repetition to this question, but I believe maybe it's, you know, hearing from a different perspective. Now, the AI adoptions in the next few years will disrupt brands' value proposition, which we were discussing, you know, on it. But however, what hosting multi-channel contact center will be possible from many other locations. What's your take on that?
Yeah.
So I think, you know, the world is getting smaller, as you speak, right? And across the globe, we are now, for instance, brands now supporting multiple countries.
Right.
It's a step forward to support different countries. And to enable that, we need to get into this space, this area of AI, and embrace this new technology. So that's my take on it,
I mean, if you look at what COVID or MCO has done to us, you can work from anywhere. That's entirely true. Our agents were all working from home. Right. But again, when they work from home, how do you actually effectively monitor them? And like what Dato' mentioned, it's about communication. It's about having the tools. And there was one innovation that the team came up with, right? Where we actually install a software to monitor the agent's laptop when they're working from home.
Correct.
And basically to be able to assure our clients that says, your information, your customer information is secured with us. And that's the investment that we put in ourselves.
Yes.
The clients didn't even have to pay for it. We actually said, okay, we're going to pay for this. We're going to invest in this. We will just do it.
Right.
And then when we did it, we showed them the data that we were able to show them and said, wow, I didn't know you guys did it. Our other vendors didn't do it. You were the only one that basically invested in this. I think that's the thing that yes, it can be done from anywhere, but ultimately, the guys that deliver for you, the guys that are here, the team that is delivering, makes the difference. Right?
So would CAPEX be increased, say, you know, with the direction of what brand is going to go forward? I mean, using the AI adoption in the event if our brand is going to start expanding our markets across regionally, will this be significantly impacting the CAPEX then?
From a technology perspective, I would think that it's not CapEx. It's very much we are operating on the SaaS, on the cloud
SaaS model.
So it's on cloud. So everything it's really OpEx driven. But certainly there are still CapEx to be involved if in terms of expansion, and that's primarily very much in the real estate where you know we are expected to have people who's going to come to office to operate. Where the clients requires us to actually have the team intact on site, right? So those are situations where essentially we will still have to invest in CapEx. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right, there you go. Thank you so much. I believe we have covered up what we needed to know. I mean, what I personally need to know. And of course, for the reference of the live viewers who are tuning in, and also the viewers who will be watching a replay at the comfort of their house at any time on our Facebook page as Invest AQ and Brandt International. There you go, folks. Unfortunately, when you have great time, time flies very fast. And of course, today is, we not only had one, but we have three. So basically, jobs was actually being divided in three. So of course, there were a lot of insights, there were a lot of information, but those who want to take the next action plan to be taking action right now with moving forward with Brandt International after understanding the vision and mission, do click on the link for you to express your interest. And this interest we will be forwarding you the right and the relevant information about Brandt International to be part of this one and only ACF campaign opportunity and to grow with Brandt International. So the link is flashed on the screen, as you could see right now. So once again, thank you to all live viewers who have been tuning in in the last 60 minutes with us. And I'd like to thank also our panelists today, Andrew, Richard, and Datuk, for really coming on set and to really give us such a very well detailed description about Brandt in the past, present, and the future. And I think this is truly an epitome of what a dynamic team is it's about. So with that, I'd like to thank you and have a wonderful week ahead. Thank you very much, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I guess in Malaysia, when we talk about ECF, it actually started only in 2016. And, even though we have been monitoring this platform for a while, and initially the thought of the ECF is primarily targeted for startups, but we begin to see that, SME companies and non-tech companies has also benefited from this campaign as well. So that's one. And secondly, we are also beginning to see that there is also a lot of government supporting these platforms, especially as we saw in the latest 2021 budget announcements, where it's giving tax exemptions for people who actually invest in the ECF platform. So that actually builds a lot of conviction and confidence in this platform, coupled with the fact that this year represents our record year in terms of top line as well as the bottom line. And as such, we believe that we do have a very strong storyboard as well as a strong case whereby the investors can benefit from us. And we're also seeing the disruptive technology does have an impact on BPO operators, because now we're beginning to see more of the mundane tasks that's going to be taken away, and as such, this would impact BPO organizations as well. So it is critically and it's important for BPO organizations to start focusing on innovation. And when we talk about innovation, it's just beyond products and services, but the ability to develop innovations even within their operations as well, so that you can continuously stay relevant.
We are actually looking at perhaps the second round of fundraising, where, you know, potentially we are primarily looking at real strategic investors. And what we really mean by strategic investors are two key criteria. One, it's really about accessibility to funding to assist us to actually expand and scale, and even having fundings for potential M&A targets. And the second key thing for us that we're looking at as a strategic partner, it's actually market access. Well, there are actually two possible options for us. One, it's the trade sales, and the other one, it's essentially the IPO. What is really important at this point for us is to focus on value creation regardless of each option. I think it is important that the exit has to be meaningful for all the stakeholders. So we're going to kind of focus on the organic growth for the time being. But surely if there are opportunities for an inorganic growth, we will probably be looking at those opportunities as well. Well, as far as we see ourselves, number one, it's that, you know, we are experiencing a double-digit growth at this point. Even we have proven ourselves, we are not a startup. So there's really no startup risk for any potential investors. We have 16 years of proven track records, and we have proven ourselves that we are currently ready to scale. And also, more importantly, obviously, it's the fact that, you know, the business is essentially driven largely by a team of very experienced management team who have at least more than 15 years experience in the BPO industry.